Hello and welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy, and I am joined by the hip hop and globetrot. Oh, I already went wrong. I'm joined by the hip hop and globetrot and throwback in live action music video himself. Hashtag the boombox. It's Buffa. How you doing?
Man, thanks for having me. Happy to be here. And you got it right, man. You got it right.
I would
I
be
see
absolutely
you've
awesome.
been
I just read your Twitter bio, but that's fine.
reading
But I've asked you on because you've started to develop this quite a reputation thanks to the LKS Dojo and Liu Kang Sharp and everyone that seems to pass by your guidance. Seems to be that you seem to get held in high regard. So I thought, why not have Buffett on the show and talk a little bit about just the ins and outs and hows. So we'll start with the basics, the most boring cliche question you can get on a podcast, but it's a nice icebreaker. What got you into pro wrestling? So what was the moment you watched on TV or video games or whatever? What got you into pro wrestling?
Man, WWF superstars. That's what got me hooked. I wasn't interested in prior to that. So I would say maybe, I think it was 93. I was what, 10 years old, 9, 10 years old. And I was a big fan of X-Men cartoon. I was big into comics, action movies, Van Damme, Bruce Lee, Eddie Murphy. Wrestling wasn't my thing, So I didn't really pay attention to it too much. I had like the old toys that, what was they called? The LJN toys, the big ones.
Oh yeah, the
Big
ones that
plastic
didn't
ones.
bend, they were just big lumps of plastic, yeah.
I was always like around wrestling somehow, some way, whether it was like action figures or like the little trading cards they had like back in like the 80s, like WWF. So I always know about it, but I didn't get hooked to it because I never really gave wrestling a chance. Because at the time, I was raised by my mom, single mom, and my older sister. So we only had like, I think maybe one TV. So when my mom was at work, my sister, she's about 6 years older than me. So she had the TV. So I couldn't watch anything I wanted really. So I didn't see much wrestling. I knew about it because kids in school would talk about it, but I thought wrestling was corny. So I never paid it too much mind until one day I was watching X-Men with my brother and they happened to be playing a rerun. So he was like, we've seen this episode already. So we flicked through the channels and we came across WWF Superstars and it was Lex Luger. And I remember he beat one of the Quebecers that wound up beating up the other Quebecer, wound up beating up Johnny Polo. So I was like, oh shit, this guy beat up three guys by himself, and he's all jacked. He's like a comic book, like superhero. So I'm like, wow, man, this is pretty cool, So ever since then, I was hooked because I always wanted to be an actor. So I was like, oh shit, wrestling is fighting, acting, it's everything in one. So I was like, yeah, this is what I want to do. This is what I want to be. So ever since then, I was hooked. 93. Which
93.
is like the worst year in the
I was
so
about
many
to say,
states.
and when it comes to cut, it actually seems to bleed perfectly into what you enjoyed though, because 93 was probably at its peak cartoony, and all the cartoon characters. You had your so it needed to be that for you to enjoy it at the time.
I loved it. I like all the different characters. I was hooked. I was like, yeah, this is what I'm into. Like, I'm watching X-Men for crying out loud. All the bright colors, all the different gimmicks in the comic books that you see, WWF, you got all these different characters. And I'm like, this is perfect. Live action. Like, it's no better than that. So, yeah, 93. Got hooked.
So was
Ever
Luger
since.
always your guy from that point onwards then? Was always Lex Luger?
At first, he was. Because that was, I would say that was the first wrestling match I watched like all the way through. Like I would come across wrestling here and there, but like my sister would change the channel or my cousins would change the channel because nobody was really into wrestling, like in my family. So I would see like clips of this, clips of that. But that was like the first actual match I watched, like all the way through. So Lex Luger was a favorite of mine at that time. Then when I saw 1-2-3 Kid, that was it. I was like, oh, I think 1-2-3 Kid is like my age. He's over here beating these grown men. I'm like, oh, I can do this. Look at him. I'm thinking he's my age. I'm thinking he's my size. But I'm like, if he could do it, I could do it. So 1-2-3 Kid ever since. Yeah.
I love hearing stories about this, but going back, like when I started watching wrestling, it was just Attitude Era. So I started 99, around about then. So I was 9 years old at the time. So I was still very young. I probably shouldn't have been watching it at that time. But yeah, the more I go back to it, the more I realize how good X-Pac and just Sean Waltman in general, just how underrated he was. I think nowadays, now people are going back and there's more access to all this kind of stuff. People are realizing that he was good. Yeah. This phrase X-Pac Heat was rubbish because he always got a reaction, mostly booze. Yeah. He always got a reaction. So,
easily, like, he could work with anybody. Like, it didn't matter if a guy was his size, smaller, bigger, he could have a good match with anybody. Like, I can't even think of any bad matches he's had in, like, that whole run in, like, WWF, WWE, like, there's some matches in, like, WCW I wasn't really a fan of, but I know he was, like, going through stuff, and he was, yeah, but, like, his run in WWE, WWF, like, just nothing but, like, classic matches, man. You could just name, like, I could name easily, like, 10 classic matches of his in, like, WWE just alone.
Absolutely.
So, yeah,
he's a
man.
I've been lucky enough to see him wrestle live in where I am, up in the northeast of Scotland. So he's just, yeah, underrated. I think we can positively say about X-Pac. So from that point, 93, then you started watching it. You're 10 years old. So I've got written down here that you made your debut about 2001. So when did you actually go from thinking, right, I'm going to do this. This is my. I'm going to be an actor / wrestler. I'm going to do all that to actually pursue.
Yeah. Oh man! At that time, I started catching up on the years I missed, because I had a local video store around the corner from my house. So I would go there and rent all the old wrestling tapes and catch up on all the years I missed. And that's how I found out about, like, guys having different gimmicks. You know, like, Big Coleman was part of the militia before. And I'm like, wow. So I was teaching myself the past history. So I caught up to, like, 93, 94. I watched, like, everything I could find from WWF, NWA, WCW. And was just, like, taking all that in, you know. And I was also buying the magazines. I would buy any and every wrestling magazine I could find. Read it front through back, like, find out who was the guys on the indies, and I would try to find matches of theirs, because I'm like, oh, I heard of this guy, heard of that guy, but I never seen him. So I found it was a local indie in New York called USA Pro. They would do shows in colleges in the Bronx. So I came across, I think I found out about them. It was either a flyer or in the magazine in Public Enemy. This is like, what year was that? Public Enemy, they were still in WCW at this time. So I guess, like, at that time, like, some of the WCW guys would do, like, some indies. So Public Enemy was doing an indie in the Bronx. So me and my brother got tickets, so we went to the indie show. And I was like, oh, wow. See, Superfly, Jimmy Snooker, Greg Valentine, Public Enemy, they pulled the no-show. But me and my brother had a blast, you know. We got to see, like, wrestling, like, up close and personal, because we used to go to the MSG, we used to go to the house shows, WWF, the pay-per-views, the Raws, and all that. But it's different at an indie show, you know, because we ain't got the restrictions with the barricades and all that. You can see the guys just going to the concession stand to get food and all that. You get your autographs. So It was a cool experience, and I was like, yeah, man, we got to do this. We felt at this point in time that we could actually do it, because before we go to the house shows at MSG, and it's like, yeah, we're there, we're live, but it's not the same intimate feeling as a indie show. So ever since then, we was just like searching for schools, and there was only one wrestling school in New York at the time that I knew about, and it was Johnny Rods in Brooklyn. But Johnny Rods only trained you if you was 18 years old. At this time, I'm like 15 years old, so I'm like, oh man, damn, he's not gonna take me, you know. So I did a little more searching. Then one of my friends told me that he found a school in Brooklyn that he was training at. So I was like, oh yeah. So he was like, yeah, just and I'll take you guys there. So we didn't find this place for like, it took like a year. We just heard about it. Like, some of our friends had went to the school and they wrestled and they telling us, like, man, it was great. It was in a real wrestling ring. We wrestling, like, yo, we want to go back. And he's like, we think it's closed. So we're just trying to find this place, can't find it. Then my friend who told me about it, he was like, oh, that place is closed, but there's another place in a boxing gym. So I was like, a boxing gym ring, but it's all good. Like, we could wrestle in it. So we went to this boxing gym called Jerome's Gym in the Bronx. And my first experience was wrestling in a boxing ring, a hard boxing ring. And that lasted, like, I think I did like maybe like two shows inside that boxing gym. I was like, some other guys came and they broke the boxing ring, because the deal was we could have the ring to ourselves for like about 3 hours, but everybody had to pay $5. And it was only on Sundays and there wasn't any boxing training. So we did like two shows. 1 week we did a show, then maybe like a month later we did another show. Then after the second show, we found out that some other group came in and they broke the ring. So they was like, no more wrestling. So that was it for about, I say, about 6 months. Then we finally got to the wrestling school in Brooklyn that we was hearing so much about, because they had shut down and opened up a new location. So we went to the new location and that was it. That was it.
Just the drama through all that. So it's yeah. So this mysterious wrestling school you had to try and find, and then when eventually found it was closed, and then you'd go to another place, and they got vandalized, and it must be your commitment to want to be a wrestler that you've
Was.
did that. You took the journey. You tried to fight it, and all that.
It's been a journey for sure. It
A
was
boxing
a
ring, though.
tradition, what happened.
Oh,
I went
that's.
through like the back door. I took the long way around because I didn't even make it like I didn't even get charged like tuition at the wrestling school. We would just rent the ring for like 3 hours, like the same deal as the boxing gym. They would let us rent the ring for 3 hours, and everybody had to pay $10 each. So you think, and like, it was no lie, it was like 50 of us.
The guy's
Was
making a
50
killing
of us.
every
Yeah,
week.
exactly. So these guys, they was already like indie wrestlers. So they would do. My school was open every day, every single day, and they would do live shows every Saturday, no matter what. Rain, sleet, snow, it'd be one person in there, it'd be 500 in there. They didn't care. Like, there was gonna be a live show every week, no matter what. So we would go and we would rent the ring for 3 hours. Then the indie guys would see us and be like, oh wow, you guys have some potential. Like, you guys are pretty good for not having any experience. So like, me and my brother, we knew like we wasn't going to get anywhere doing these like little, we called them like small indie shows. It's like a level above backyard wrestling,
Right.
because he wasn't backyard wrestling, he was in an actual ring and an actual wrestling school. So we called it small indies. So we just asked one of the trainers there, And he's like, yeah, you know, what do we have to do to become pro wrestlers? He's like, you know what we're doing now is going to get us to where we want to be. So he was just like, oh, he was like, you know, just come here, like, make it to, like, training at least, like, 3 days a week, and I'll train you guys, and you guys will eventually get put on the shows and all that.
I bet bumping on an actual ring for the first time was just like throwing yourself onto a bed in comparison to a boxing ring. It was just the tiniest thin padding is probably the best thing you felt in that moment.
It was a relief, but it wasn't as soft as I thought it was going to be. It was still rough. Like, that ring was pretty stiff, you know. But the hardest thing I noticed was, like, at first was the ropes. Because in the boxing ring, I didn't really, like, run the ropes. Because, you know, the boxing ropes are crazy. Like, it would be insane to try to run those ropes. So when I actually, like, had to, like, learn how to run the ropes in the actual wrestling ring, that was pretty tough, you know. Just getting used to, like, going into the cables and all that. Because this ring, like, they use the cables. They didn't use, like, the actual, like, ropes. Like ring ropes, these were like cables, so it's pretty rough at first.
That seems to be pretty common. A common comment when I'm asking people how they felt in their first couple sessions and that it's like, but the mats, but the ropes are the worst thing, because just you don't if you don't take them right, you get rope burn. If you do take them right, you probably still get rope burn anyway. The thought of it's hurting my back, and I've never done it. I've grabbed a rope to get in for a photo. That's about as far as I'm happy to go for it. So those first few matches then, I don't know if you've got any footage of them. Have you been able to look back and see them? Or is it just one of those cases where you're just like, no, it's fine. Move on to the next one. Let's just keep going. Or
I have tons of footage. The thing is, a lot of the footage is in storage. And a lot of that footage is on the old VHS tapes. So you need a VCR to see them. I was able to convert a lot of them over to YouTube. But some of my older stuff, it's like it's still on VHS tapes. So when I go back to New York, I'm going to dig all that stuff out of storage and upload it. But I got to have a few things on YouTube, a few old matches from like 2001. Yeah, I still got a few. On YouTube, yeah. So I like to go back and look at that stuff, man, because that's what made me better. I would go back and study my old matches and rearrange things, you know, do some things I haven't done in like years. So I definitely look back at that stuff with like good memories. You know, that's what made me. So I never like throw it to the side and forget about it. Hell nah. No way. That's part of my history. I love it.
So just for everyone else listening that's under the age of, I don't know, how old am I, 33? So under the age of 25, a VHS was a tape that you rewound yourself, just in case, because DVDs are becoming great. Obsolete now. It's so scary. It's so...
Yeah, like, what the hell? Man, but I'll tell you one thing. I was never a big fan of, like, DVDs and CDs. I was more a fan of, like, VHS tapes. Because, you know, DVD, CD, get a little scratch on it, it's over.
That's VHS it. VHS
tapes, you could crack them. I used to, like, take them apart and put them in different, like, cassettes.
I know, this is not wrestling related at all, but there's a YouTube or TikTok channel that I come across, and it is just guys that if they've got, like, for example, off the top of my head, like, say the Barbie movie, for example, they were able to get on VHS, they would like convert it into a pink tape and all that kind of stuff. And I don't know if it's just my age at this point, but it's fascinating to watch. Just watching them cassettes in different colors.
I love watching stuff like that, man. That's awesome.
It's like the graininess, like records. You get the little cracks and the grains and all that kind of stuff.
I love that, man. That's so good. Music to my ears.
So we're gonna skip a lot because you've had a over 20-year career. So there's I noticed on YouTube there's this big like 4-hour interview that you've done that was just after the pandemic and that. And I think if anyone's interested, I'm sure they will be hearing your full story. That's probably a good place to go. So we'll kind of skip in that. But so you can go back and watch your old matches and you pick and take things from it. Where did the boombox come from?
Oh man, that was an idea I had in my head for quite some time. Like me and my brother, when we was wrestling as All Money Is Legal, we wanted to change up our image. It was after our first tour together of Japan. They had changed our names because the Buffa name that was given to me, the Buffa name was given to me, the Part-Time Lover theme song was given to me by one of the former owners of Pro Wrestling 01. When me and my brother was doing our first tour there, he asked me, he was like, the owner had asked me, what's your theme song? I was like, oh, if he was using LL Cool J, I'm Bad. So he was like, I think this song we have for you is better. So I'm like, what song? He's like, Stevie Wonder, Part-Time Love. I'm like, I was so against it because I'm like, how is this going to work? And he was like, the name too, like, what you think about Buffa or Zuffa? I was like, Buffa. So he was like, all right, cool. So, like, every guy, they changed my name. They changed our names. We was called the Buffa Brothers in Japan. So I was like, they changed our names. They gave us a new theme song. I was like, when we come back to the States, let's just like switch up the image, because we wanted to do like a playoff of the rap group Kid and Play. I don't know if you're familiar with them.
I've heard the name.
Movie called House Party. Yeah. They do the dance, the kick and spin, little dance. So we want to do something like that, slash like Run DMC. We wanted to like be a throwback, you know, to like 80s, 90s hip hop. But we didn't want to fully commit to like the flat tops, you know, like the flat top fades. So I was like, oh man, I wanted to like go all in with it. I wanted to get the high flat top and all that. But I was like, damn, to upkeep that on the indies, I'm like, that's going to take a lot of money. And indies ain't paying well enough. I'm like, I don't want to waste it on the indies. I don't want to go all in on it. So I kind of backed off on it. But I was like, let's just change our names from All Money Is Legal to The House Party. So that's what we did. And we wound up wearing like the Adidas. We went on with like the Run DMC look at first. So I was like, all right. Everybody used to say, oh, you look like LL Cool J. So I was like, all right, cool. I'll come out with the boom box. We wear the Adidas sneakers instead of wearing like kick pads and Asics and wrestling boots. So I switched to the sneakers. This before, like, anybody was wearing sneakers to wrestle. The only person that was wearing sneakers to wrestle was like John Cena at the time. Now everybody and their moms wear sneakers. They don't even go with their image or gimmicks. It's just ridiculous now. But we switched to the sneakers. I was like, all right, get the hats, the cane goes, the chains, the glasses, and just get the whole look going. So that's why we switched it up. It's just a throwback to like our environment, where we came from, what we was into. Because at the time, you know, in the 80s, we were young. We couldn't like buy the gold chains. We couldn't buy the big boom box and all that. I mean, if he was old enough, he would have been dressing like that anyways, but we was too young. So,
right. You
know, now that we're older, we can have this stuff and wear it, you know. So I was like, yeah, let's just do that because nobody's doing anything like that. So
yeah,
just switch it up.
I like that. So after kind of getting stripped of everything in Japan, you were like, no, I'm just going to do the thing I want to do. I absolutely understand the doing like the things you do when now you're grown up that you want to do, because I mean, as you can see, my background is literally just toys and crap and all stuff that I wanted when I was younger. I've got a Turbo Man action figure behind me as well, and it's like, this is all the stuff I wanted when I was younger, belts and all that, and I couldn't afford it, and now I'm I've got adult money and I'll just buy it all kind of thing. Until I don't have any adult money, and I'm just sitting with all my stuff, like some sort of king of toys. But it's a striking look. Like I said, it's not something that people were doing. I mean, nowadays the throwbacks, like, it's cool kind of thing. But you were doing it just round about early mid 2000s and late 2000s, which
2009.
So this would have been after you've been seeing acts like I'm trying to think. I was thinking like Crime Time, and that people might think that that would be the stereotype you would go into, but you just went absolutely the other way, and it was just a party vibe instead.
Yeah, man, the whole Crime Time thing, like, well, that's another story. Like I said, I used to hate getting compared to them. I'm like, that's like, we was out first, you know what I mean? Yeah. And I hear them saying things in their promo that me and my brother said like 2-3 years ago. Like that, their finisher move is a move me and my brother was doing in like 2002, 2003, the freaking Samoan drop, flipping neck breaker. But my brother would flip off the second rope and do the flipping neck breaker, and I would do the Samoan drop. Then, like a few years later, that's their finish. Like, yeah. I was just like, at that point, I'm like, I was being resourceful because so many people is just like taking stuff from my style, like taking pages out of our book. Not giving us credit, making it seem like they created it. It's like, here we go again. You know, it's just one of those situations. So we went to Japan, and it was kind of like a blessing in disguise, you know, because we needed a change. So that's another reason why we started to go back to the more old school look, you know, because nobody was doing it at that point in time. So it was perfect. Yeah, perfect time.
So was that move to Japan for the tour initially? Was it always an Asian culture that you enjoyed? Because of course now you reside in China. So as soon as you went there, you're like, yeah, this is I can dig this. I could live here in this kind of part of the world.
Because in New York City, there's, you know, you have like Chinatown, but that's like downtown Manhattan. I lived in the Bronx. Well, I lived in Harlem first, then I moved to the Bronx. But in New York City, there's like Chinese corner. Like every single corner, there's either like a freaking liquor store or there's a Chinese restaurant. That's just the way it is in New York City, especially at that time. I haven't been there in a while, so I don't know if it's still the same, but at that time, it's like Chinese restaurants every corner. So I was always around the culture. You know, I would always like buy Chinese food. I was into like Bruce Lee, like I said, Van Damme. I always like watch the freaking kickboxer movies. Bloodsport, one of my favorite movies, which was filmed in Hong Kong. So it's just crazy how I wound up living in Hong Kong. I live in China, mainland China, but this is Shenzhen. Shenzhen is right next to Hong Kong. So I live like a few minutes away from Hong Kong. So I just knew like I would wind up like somewhere in Asia, especially once like I got into wrestling and I would see guys like Chris Benoit, Eddie Guerrero, and Dean Malenko when they debuted in WCW. They would always talk about how they was on a summer tour in Japan. And I would see their style, and I'd be like, yo, I like that style. And WCW always had, like, the working relationship with, like, New Japan. So you see all the different, like, Japanese guys coming, passing through, and I would look at their style, and I'd be like, yo, their style is so different. Like, it's more, like, hard-hitting, more brutal, more realistic. So that's what, like, attracted me to, like, Japan. So I always wanted to go to Japan. I wanted to start my career in Japan, but I started at, 15, so how the hell was I going to get to Japan inside a dojo at the age of 15? That wasn't going to happen, so it took about a few years. I think it's about 10 years into my career when I got the opportunity to go to Japan, so which was good because I was already, like, pretty seasoned, you know. So once I got there and got a taste of the training, I was like, all right, this is cool. I'm ready for it. Because if I would have went like earlier, I don't think I would have survived the fucking dojo, because the dojo training was rough. And the lifestyle, I don't think I would have been able to survive that at a younger age, you know, especially like less experience. So 10 years in was a good amount of time before I like got an opportunity with Japan, because I was more than ready at that point. So everything worked out.
You talk about the hard-hitting style then. Is that what attracted you to things like, I suppose it's hard-hitting in a different sense, but things like CCW and that, it's hard-hitting, but it's more weapon-based, I suppose. But always a thought, just make it look real?
Yeah, definitely, like, more so ECW, that's what attracted me to CZW, like, the style. Not so much the hardcore stuff, because I wasn't into that, but there was, like, a lot of, like, guys who could wrestle, who could work, you know? And I would see a lot of, like, matches there that were, like, solid matches, like, matches you would, like, technical matches you would see at ECW, with, like, Rob Van Dam and Jerry Lynn, you know, Mikey Whipwreck, like guys who don't do so much of the hardcore stuff, but they're technically sound. So I would see guys in CZW like Trent Acid, you know, Johnny Cashmere, Backseat Boys, Briscoes, SAT, and I'm like, oh, this is cool. Like, it has that ECW feel, but you know, you have guys here. Yeah, they and my brother work, so I'm like, yeah, we could fit in perfectly here. So I was like, yeah, that's a goal. A goal of ours was to go to CZW, and we got there pretty early, man. Like, we started in 2001, then our wrestling school closed in 2002. So when it closed, we started working for the Samoans in Pennsylvania, the Alpha of the Wild Samoan, Sam Moore, and the Head Shrinkers. We started working there in 2003. Then from there, we got the opportunity with CZW in 2004. So like a year into the Indies, we were already in CZW. So like, yeah, things were happening so quick. Then like 2003, we worked with the Samoans, which was great because it was the only like indie company that had live TV. And they also had like a deal with WWE. It is like a developmental deal because Gene Snitsky was there when we debuted. We wrestled him in like one of our like third matches in WXW with the Samoans. Then he wound up getting called up to WWE and got contracted. So we got a lot of solid experience working for WXW because we learned how to work TV and live TV at that. So once we went to CZW, we was just cooking. Then after that, we got the opportunity with Shikara Pro, which is Shikara Pro, through CZW, and that's where we worked El Generico and Kevin Steen in one of their tag tournaments. So it was just, everything was hitting. Like, I say like 2004, 2005 was probably like two of our like best years. We were working for like all like the top companies in the Northeast, so everything was going great, man. It was a good time, and that's when wrestling was on fire. You know, the Indies was just, it was over, man. I was like, that's a real boom period. People say now is a boom period. Nah, look at 2001 through like 2005. Like, that's when it was like the best. Like, if it wasn't for that era, this era right now would be like, it wouldn't even exist. You know, I was like part of like some of the best eras in wrestling. So to see what happened to the wrestling business now, like, it's like, yeah, pros and cons, but for me, it's more cons than pros. So that's why I don't even watch a lot of wrestling anymore. I just watch old stuff I grew up on, you know. I don't really pay attention too much.
It's just a case of, I mean, I know for myself that, oh, I try to watch pay-per-views, but I can't now. I've got a one-year-old son, so it just doesn't happen. But it's a case of just going YouTube, just see the highlights, see what so-and-so is doing at the moment. And that's kind of, and I listen to podcasts. That's kind of how I keep up to date now with what's going on. And if they say something's happening, I'm like, oh, okay, I'll go see that out. I'll go find it.
If it catches my attention, I'll like check it out, you know. But other than that, I'm not looking for anything, you know, already I know what's going on without searching for it, because I go on social media and everything is just in my face, whether I want to see it or not. So
yeah,
I don't really need to search for anything. I pretty much know what's going on, because I still have friends in the business that's in AEW, WWE, and all that. So I know what's going on. Like, I watch their stuff from time to time. If they ask me to check it out, or if I just happen to come across it, I'll give it a watch. But like, the younger me that was fresh in the busy single bit of wrestling I could find, watching every wrestler, because I'm like, someday I might work this guy, so I want to be able to learn his style and learn how to mesh minds into his style and have a good match and all that. So I would watch everything. But nowadays, I'm like, like, you can't even pay me to watch some of this stuff. I'm like, nah, it ain't happening.
I was speaking to Joey Legend for one of these podcasts recently, and he was pretty much the case of, he's a wrestler. He goes, sees wrestlers, he spends time wrestlers, does seminars with wrestlers. Why would you want to watch wrestling outside of that when it's his job to be a wrestler?
Yeah.
So, and when you put it like that, I was like, yeah, that's the last thing. I mean, I work my real job, I work in insurance. So I spent 8 hours a day, 5 days a week in insurance. That's the last thing I want to speak about or think about outside of that time. So it's the same for wrestlers, I suppose.
It's good to see it that way too, because a lot of people don't. Like, I have like family members that send me stuff like wrestling related, and it has nothing to do with anybody like I know. So I'm like, I'm not watching that. Like, and I'm like, this is trash. People like, why is it trash? I'm like, I'm not even trying to explain this. I'm just like,
I get I'm paid to do this at a seminar. I don't want to do it in my home life as well.
Like, I'm at the point now where I'm transitioning into like being not only a business owner, but a full-time trainer. Like, I train guys in Hong Kong. I'm opening up my dojo here in China soon. You know, I'm doing the same thing. I'm like watching the matches of the guys I've been helping out, guys that I took under my wing. I watch their matches when they send it to me, or if I come across it, yeah, for sure. So the last thing I'm trying to do is watch like any like TV wrestling. I'm over it, you know.
Yeah, I mean, especially if you're watching the guys that you train, it's your investment. They've invested in your training, so you're invested in them actually learning what you've taught them at the same time. So it all makes sense. Speaking of dojos then, because that's kind of one of the main things, that's how your name kind of cropped up in my radar, was through things like Looking Sharp's dojo, and you did the online stuff during the pandemic. How did that come about? Was it just a case of he contacted you and went, do you want to do this? Or did you come across each other when he was in China for, was it OWE?
Yeah, OWE. Yeah, that's where we met. That's where we met and connected and became brothers. It all started in OWE. So ever since then, you know, we always kept in touch. And I was always planning on coming to the UK. I was always planning on doing a tour of Europe. So once the pandemic happened, that kind of shut things down. Like, right before the borders in China got shut down, I was supposed to come to Europe. That's supposed to be my first trip out there. I had everything set up, lined up. Then that's when we got the news that they was closing the borders. So I was like, oh, damn. Because China got shut down first before, like, any other countries, you know. So once China got shut down, I was like, oh, everybody else is going to get shut down too. It's just a matter of time. And sure enough, like a few weeks later, like Europe got shut down, freaking America got shut down, everything is just done. So I was like, damn. So once the borders open again in Europe and the UK, I was like, yeah, I'm out. Because the borders were still closed in China. So I was like, I'm not leave until the borders in China open up, because I won't be able to come back in. So I was like, all right, cool, I'm ready, because I was locked down, not locked down necessarily, like I couldn't leave the house or anything like that, but I was locked down within the country. And I'm used to like bouncing from country to country, like on a weekly basis, you know? So that was the longest I've been without wrestling in like 20 something years. Like the longest I've been out the ring was like 6 months in 20 years. So once the borders open in the UK, I was ready to get the hell out of China, man. I couldn't get there any faster. So well, that's when I came left.
It's one of those things where you spend your life wanting to immerse yourself in the Asian culture and go over to China, and then after 2 years, you're like, no, get me out. I need to go yeah. now. I've done it. I've done everything. Yeah. I've completed it. Let's just get out.
That was rough, man, because prior to that, the longest I've stayed within like mainland China was in the OWE when I was there with Chris, Liu Kang Shaw. And I was there for like 3 months in Shanghai. So after like the companies, like it got to a point where we, like the writing was on the wall. We knew the company was going to shut down soon. So I got out of Dodge early. I left before Chris left. I left about a month before Chris left, and I went back to Hong Kong. Then I found out that, you know, everything was shutting down and they was like relocated. They was on a, who was it they were supposed to go? No, they relocated to Cambodia. So they left China, relocated to Cambodia. Then once like Chris found that out, he was like, yeah, we out of here too. So he wound up leaving as well. Then after that, like we stayed in contact and he like told me that he was gonna start doing like the online dojo. So he was like, if you interested, just let me know, man. We could get you on and do like the seminars and all that. So I was like, yeah, hell yeah, because it was during like the pandemic. Had nothing else to do, you know? So I wanted to do something wrestling related. So I was like, yeah, hell yeah, let's make it happen, man. So that's when I jumped on board.
Yeah. He brought in so many different people as well. I mean, I was like, I was part of, I jumped in one of them, just one of his free ones that he was doing with Krieger about tag team wrestling, and it was an hour, and it was just so fascinating. It's all stuff that I've now got in my head now when I'm watching tag team matches and things like just how they're set up, put together, and it's just great when you know, now that you know that information and the information you give your students, it's like watching wrestling in a totally different way. You know, when they don't follow the kind of rules, it's just
like it enhances the match even more when you're watching it from that point of view, when you know, like, the little, like, minor details, you know, that goes into, like, a wrestling match with, like, the psychology, the comebacks and stuff like that. Once you see it from that point, it's like, oh, man, that's why I still watch, like, old stuff. That's why I don't just watch wrestling. I study wrestling. Still to this day, I study wrestling. I watched the old stuff, the stuff I grew up on, the stuff I didn't notice when I was a kid watching these matches, you know? So I could watch it from like a fan's point of view and a worker's point of view. So that makes it even better, you know, because I'm listening to the different crowd reactions, you know, the comebacks, you know, feeding to the crowd at this point, waiting, giving them a little bit, taking it away. Just seeing how they work the matches with the psychology and like how different people go about different things, and like, you know, it's just cool as hell, man. That's what I try to like teach to the students. Like I try to teach them how to study matches, because that's one thing, you got to know how to study matches and what to look for. Because I remember when I was coming up, like Homicide, he didn't to help train me. It's been so many guys. That's like my thing was, I never wanted to be trained by just one person. I wanted to learn from everybody. So I would go to one person for like a few months. Then I'll go to the next person. Because I know everybody has different ways of doing different things. This way may not work for me, but that way may work for me better. So I like to learn from everybody. But one of the things he used to always tell me was to study matches. But at the time, it's like 2001, I didn't really understand that. He's like, study matches, but he didn't tell me how to study matches, what to look for. And I would always be like so confused, like, okay, so I would watch matches, but I didn't know what to really look for. I'm looking at spots and moves and stuff like that. So I'm over here like looking at certain spots that are cool, and I'm like, yeah, I want to do that and just switch it up. But nah, it's not about that, you know? There's so much more that goes into like studying matches instead of like just still the moves and still the spots and stuff like that, you know? So yeah, that's another thing that I teach the guys, like how to study, what to look for, you know?
Yeah, that kind of feeds into a question that we got. We got a question from Fulton King, who trains at the LKS Dojo, and he's that kind of feeds into that thought. He's put, you've trained and worked with some of the greatest wrestlers around the world, from Mikey Whipwreck to the SAT. What are some of the best pieces of advice you still keep with you? So you talked about studying matches, but is there any other pieces of advice that you always kept and try to instill?
Oh, yeah. And it's funny how he mentioned Mikey Whipwreck. And shout out to Fulton King. That's one of my guys, man. That's one of my guys. Him and Sammy, that just never died. That's a team that Chris and I put a lot of work into, and they're doing great. I'm happy for those guys. Like, it was a year ago when I first met them, and been working with them ever since, man. And a year later, I'm like, wow, they listen. That's what I love. They listen, because one of the problems I have here with the guys in China is they don't listen. Like Hong Kong and mainland China, two different animals. Hong Kong, the guys listen. That's why I'm one of the trainers there. That's why I'm invested in that company. Those guys listen. But mainland China, forget about it. One ear, out the other. So that's why I'm starting my own thing. I'm not even wrestling for these companies in China anymore. Only company I'm working for in China is my own. Once I get up and running. But one of the main pieces of advice that I keep with me, and it's funny he mentioned Mike Whipwreck, because he's the one who told me this. He said, less is more. He drilled that into me and my brother's head, less is more. And at the time, I totally got it, because this was like 2000 and maybe 12. So I was like about experience. Just like did my tours in Japan, lived in Japan, went through the dojo system. So I had it upstairs. So I was able to like sink everything in and, you know, apply it, because you could soak up the knowledge, but if you don't apply it, what good is it? So I always kept that in mind. That's why I like started to change my style, when I would do less. I don't do all the crazy flips that I used to do. Like I got so many clips of the like fucking reverse 450s I used to do, 450s, Phoenix Bastards, all that crazy stuff I used to do. I stopped doing it. And I started taking like simple moves and add a little twist to it. That's why when I do the one-legged drop kick, I do the flip with it. Or I do the elbow drop, but atomic drop, shoot the legs, jump through the legs and drop the elbow. I do like little simple moves, add a little twist to it. Less is more. I don't have to do like a bunch of moves, a bunch of spots. I just go off of my charisma, let my charisma shine more than the moves. We all say, hey, yo, crowd reaction, you know, engage the crowd, like feed off of the crowd, you know, instead of doing all the crazy flippy stuff. Because after a while, like people need to understand, like all this crazy stuff you do in all these spots, you got to remember, if your cardio isn't up there, you want to look foolish and you want to put yourself at risk of getting hurt or injuring someone else. So it's like, why even risk it? You know, just think smarter, like apply yourself more. It's easy to do all the flippy, floppy, high spots and all that. Imagine if I started doing all those flips again at my size now, and all the charisma that I have, if I start doing that now, people would be like, why are you doing all that? Yeah. They'll see what I was doing before and they'd be like, why are you doing all these flips? Like, what's the point? Yeah, exactly. There's no point. That's why I don't do it. I can. I may throw a flip out here once in a while.
But it makes the flips more special if you only do it once in a while.
Yeah, of course. Like, it's like Muda. When Muda used to do the moonsault once a year. He went through a year building it up. Then finally he hit the moonsault, and everybody just pops. I'm like, he don't need to do all that crazy stuff anymore. Like, that's his norm, man. Like, use your psychology. That's what psychology is there for. Use the crowd. That's what they're there for. Use the ref. Like, it's like the ref is invisible in some of these matches. People don't use the ref. You a heel? Use the ref. Like, come on, man. Like, you ain't got to punch the ref. You ain't got to put hands on him, but, like,
you can intimidate them. You can all that kind of stuff. Yeah, I've found the older I've gotten, the like some of my favorite matches I've watched recently. If someone told me to break down what happened, I couldn't tell them a single move. I couldn't tell them a single. I couldn't tell you the finish. I couldn't tell you what happened in the match itself. But I knew how I felt, and that's the bit that it's. I found it's most important now. If the most classic example of that of less is more is WWE did a tour up in Aberdeen. And it was a 6-man tag match. It was the Wyatt family when Randy Orton was in it against, I don't know, Kane, etc., whatever. But Randy Orton did two things in that match. But every time he got in the ring, everyone went absolutely ballistic for him. And he just looked at the crowd, and then he got to the height and they tag out. And then they would wait. They would tag back in and tease an RKO, and everyone would go ballistic. They tag back out. He did literally like next to nothing in that match, and he was the most popular guy, and most everyone went crazy for him because he used the crowd and he played with them and he teased them and all that. And that was the moment where I just thought, yeah, wrestling is the moves is almost secondary. If you can use the crowd and use your charisma, the wrestling is like third in the list, maybe, of things you'd actually need.
And it's really no excuse for it, especially in the UK, because those crowds out there, man, those crowds are amazing. Some of the best crowds I've been in front of, and I've been damn near everywhere. Like, the crowds in Scotland, crowds in England, Sweden, like, oh, man, those crowds are so good. It's like, damn, man, some of you guys are just spoiled, because I came up in 2001. I wrestled in ACW Arena for CZW in 2003. And if y'all know anything about that Philly crowd in the ECW Arena, that crowd is freaking brutal. Brutal. So to see the crowds in the UK, and I'm like, ah. You guys don't know how good you got it, because they're just popping for everything. Things that they shouldn't pop for, they're popping for. But that's just like, they just love wrestling. You know, they don't care if like the guy's not that good or experienced. You know what I mean? They still want to like give him a reaction, you know, because they're just happy to be there. They're happy to see some wrestling. And that's all good. That's the type of crowds I like, you know, because some of these brutal crowds, they just like, they just want to be dicks for no reason. Like, a lot of them
could be get themselves over.
There you go, man. Get themselves over. Like, that was the whole deal with like the ECW crowd. Like, when they started coming there with gimmicks and stuff like that, it's like, all right, we already know what type of takes. It's like, come on. Like, they just want to be dicks and make the show about them and get all the attention as if they're the ones in the ring working the match. It's like, when crowds get like that, I'm just like,
I think it is. It's also like the UK crowd, we love an underdog as well, Scotland especially, because our national team's terrible. It's actually getting better now, but our national football team's was always like the worst. And we're still there chanting because we love an underdog. And so you finally made your way to Scotland 2022, and looking at the matches that you had, that is an eclectic mix of crowds and reactions, because you got ICW, which that would have been in front of like a limited crowd inside the Asylum. You would have had W3L, a bit more of a casual family crowd, Gredo's Family Bash, which is all kids and families, and then CCW, which is a little bit of a mix of everything as well. So what was it like to finally get in front of a Scottish crowd?
Man, that was awesome. I say the first, because the first match I had in Scotland was W3L, but it was at like the carnival.
All right, okay.
So it wasn't, it was outside. So it wasn't like their like main crowd, that they usually have. It was like, I can't really tell what type of crowd it is for this company, but it was still a good crowd, you know, a lot of kids there. So kids in the crowd is always good, no matter what, because they're going to react. They're going to be into it. So that's always a plus. But later that day is when I wrestled for ICW, and that crowd was awesome. It was an awesome crowd, even though it was like 110 degrees in there, and the crowd was like damn near passing out. The crowd was probably like almost 6 feet deep because it was so hot in that building, but the crowd was still with it. And after the match, I got a standing ovation, got a please come back chant, which is awesome. It's always great to get one of those. It's kind of surprising to get one of those, like, in 2022, because in 2001 through, like, 5, that was, like, one of the reactions you would get when you made your debut, had a good debut. So it reminded me of the time I debuted in CZW and got the Please Come Back chant in ACW Arena, which was awesome. So I was like, oh, wow, my debut here, Scotland, ICW, get a Please Come Back chant. My God. That's taking me back to 2004. So it was all good, man. I enjoyed it. The crowds are awesome, man. Like I can't wait to get back out there, man. It's gonna be even better this time around.
The perfect example of what you're saying about less is more, of course, working the Grado show, Family Bash, and a guy that is awesome. who is the epitome of less is more, yeah. Is Grado, who gets all the reactions and does our role. His biggest bump will be doing his own cannonball roll in the corner. That's probably about it. So it's that must again nice throwback to the family crowds. And then of course CCW with Lou King Sharp at the helm of that particular kind of show. It must have been just a nice kind of fitting roundup of your first tour, just being able to share a moment with Lou and have that match with Colton Davis and Ewan Raw, who you probably would have had a little bit of a hand on their development, man. As well. So must just be a nice...
That was good, man. Because up until that point, I was training with them like every single week. You know, Colton Davis, big strong man. Those guys are... They're the next two up. They're going to be at the top of the line in a few years in the UK for sure, man. Those are going to be the main guys. They're already, like, at this point, they're already up very close to being the main guys, like, all over Europe, for that matter. Like, they got it, man. Like, those guys are – they're two of the best. Like, all the students – out of the LKS dojos, just like they all get it. They all good. They all apply themselves. They listen, soak it in, and they don't hold back, man. They come to training to train. They don't come to WWE, AEW, any of that bullshit. They're there to train. And Lou makes them train, man. Like when they before they get in the ring, they're doing calisthenics outside in the parking lot every single week, no matter if it's freezing or raining. Like when I went back, when was it? Like last month, when I went back to Scotland for like 3 days, I was able to come to the dojo and surprise the guys and have a training session with them, and it was raining. And we're outside, and they're doing the calisthenics, and I'm just like, I'm just standing there. I'm like, let's go. I'm like, man, I'm freezing. He's putting in the work. And I'm like, that's what I love to see, man. We all out there. We all suffering too. Like, I might be standing there, like, cheering them on, you know, observing everything, but I'm suffering too, because I didn't come prepared for the cold. I got on shorts and a freaking short sleeve shirt, and I'm just getting drenched with rain. But I'm like, hey, we all out here together. Because I remember before, we would be outside jogging around the parking lot. It's freaking pouring. Everybody's just jogging, getting to work in. So, like, I was improving. Everybody's, you know, putting their best foot forward, and they're seeing the results from it. You know, I'm seeing it. Promoters are seeing it. Fans are seeing it. Other wrestlers are seeing it. So, yeah, they need to pat themselves on the back. They're doing a great job.
Perfect. I'm just seeing what time we've got here, and we've got a couple more questions on Instagram. I've got actually, I'll get our silly questions out of the way because they're ridiculous. So the first question we ask everyone on this podcast is, "What's your favorite dinosaur?"
My favorite theme song.
Dinosaur.
Oh, dinosaur.
You went for a professional question. No, that's not at all.
My favorite dinosaur. That's a good question. That one. I'm gonna have to pick one though. I guess I'll go with a T-Rex.
Nice and simple. That's fine. Nice, a classic.
Yeah.
A classic.
Yeah.
And the other question we ask everyone, and as you've spent time with Lou, you may have been part of this argument in the past. What would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Two sheep or one cow?
Oh, this was a fun question when I was asking it to people who'd only wrestled for a couple of months. But now I'm getting like, I've asked this to Scotty Too Hotty, I've asked it to yourself, I've asked it to like all these kind of established names, and I'm actually getting more embarrassed the more I ask it.
Two sheep and one cow. Who would win? I'm gonna always have to go to the 2-on-1 advantage, so I'm gonna go with the two sheep.
Perfect. That's my answer. It's still my answer after 3 years of doing this. Back to Instagram. We've got Waldo asking, which Scottish talent would you like to face that you haven't wrestled yet?
Ooh. Oh man, I don't even know, man. That's another tough one.
It's like picking one of your favorite children, isn't it? In the school and all that.
Because I wrestle with all the students at the dojo in training. But that's training, so it's a little different. But I'm going to have to pick a heel because a face-on-face doesn't always work very well. I'd rather work a heel, so I can't think, man. I just throw a name out there, BT Gunn.
That was the one I had. I was just thinking. BT Gunn. That would be a combination. So Iron Girders, you know, or CCW. Yeah. Get on it. And the last question I've got through Instagram is from Curly_Gaza. Great name. Who's your favorite opponent? I know that's a big question for who you have faced in the past, but is there any opponents out there that just everything clicked?
Man, buddy, damn, this is tough, man, because I have so many damn matches. I can't, and I work so many good guys, man. That's hard to say, man. I would have to break that down to years, countries. I don't know, man. I would say for tag team, it'd be the SAT Briscoes, Los Lunatics, DRS. Look those names up. You can see the matches on my YouTube.
Very smart. Maybe very smart.
Yeah. Damn. That's tough, man. That's tough.
Also, we'll plug the YouTube channel. Is it All Money Is Legal 1? I think it is the app.
Yeah.
So if you want to find matches from Buffa, that's the place to go then. And that's probably if you think they suck, it's not going to be on YouTube. So you're probably putting up ones that you enjoyed on the channel. Yeah,
you guys be the judge.
But
I can't choose. There's too many.
But it's been an absolute delight speaking to you. I'm glad that we got this in the book. Where can people find out more about you or anything you want to plug?
You can check me out on the social medias at Buffa underscore AO. That's 2 A's, 1 Y, triple O. And yeah.
Best place for you.
Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter, and all that. Yeah.
Excellent. That's great. Well, thank you very much for taking time to speak to me today. I'll let you get on with the rest of your day, but it's been, as I said, an absolute pleasure.
Thank you, man.